Hey guys, how's it going? Hope you're doing well. My name is Crown, and today I'm going to read you some very interesting stories that I hope that you're gonna love. And now, without further ado, let's go! So, I'm a guy with a regular 9-to-5 job in marketing, and I've always had a passion for travel. I'm not a business tycoon or anything, just a dreamer with a love for adventure. So there I was, at the gate, all set to embark on my well-deserved vacation, when all hell broke loose. I was excitedly waiting to catch my flight to a tropical paradise for a much-needed vacation. But little did I know that my patience was about to be tested by none other than an entitled whale who took tardiness to a whole new level. As the departure time was approaching, a commotion caught my attention. A person dressed in a fancy suit, dragging an oversized suitcase behind him, was sprinting towards the gate, looking like he was on a mission to save the world. This person, whom I'll call Mr. Ego, was none other than the entitled passenger we'd all soon come to know and not love. Without breaking a sweat, Mr. Ego reached the gate just as the last few passengers were boarding. But guess what? The plane had already departed. Classic scenario, right? We've all heard those last call for passengers miss announcements. You snooze, you lose. However, Mr. Ego had other ideas. Instead of accepting the consequences of their tardiness, he decided to put on a show, a dramatic performance that would put an Oscar-winning actor to shame. He yells, "Stop! Wait! Hold the plane!" The gate agent tells him, "I'm sorry, sir, but the flight has already departed. We made several announcements, and the boarding process was completed on time." Mr. Ego, now in full tantrum mode, "This is unacceptable. I'm an important businessman, and I can't afford to miss this flight. You need to bring it back right now." "Sir, I understand your frustration, but once a flight has taken off, we can't really recall it. It's for safety reasons and international regulations. There are other flights you can take later today." "This is outrageous. I demand to speak to your supervisor." The gate agent remained composed, and I couldn't help but admire their professionalism. But Mr. Ego wasn't going down without a fight. He continued his tirade, shouting and demanding that the flight be summoned back as if they were summoning a genie from a freaking lamp. Meanwhile, the rest of us passengers were watching this scene unfold, and it felt like a live episode of some reality TV show. We exchanged amused glances, trying not to burst into laughter at the absurdity of it all. Fellow passenger number one whispers to me, "Seriously? Who does this guy think he is? Captain Marvel?" Fellow passenger number two grinning, "I guess in his mind he's the CEO of the airline Avengers." As Mr. Ego's antics continued, more passengers started chiming in, pointing out the obvious, that it's impossible to recall a flight once it's in the air. Mr. Ego wasn't interested in reason, though, and continued to insist that the world should bend to their will. Mr. Ego, in a desperate attempt, says, "I have a medical condition that requires me to fly on time. You should give me special privileges." The GA firmly tells him, "I apologize if you have a medical condition, but we can't make exceptions for individual cases. The airline has strict policies to ensure the safety and convenience of all passengers." At this point, I couldn't help but wonder if Mr. Ego's medical condition was an extreme case of entitlement. It seemed like they were ready to play any card in a deck to get their way. He says, "You just don't understand how important this is. I'll miss a crucial business meeting." The GA tells him, "I sympathize with your situation, but we have other flights available later today that might suit your schedule." As the dialogue continued, I noticed that the crowd's patience was wearing thin. Someone behind me shouted, "Get over yourself, buddy. We all have places to be." And that's when things took an unexpected turn. Instead of realizing the madness of his demands, Mr. Ego decided to escalate things further. He made a wild gesture towards the gate agent's computer, trying to hit the bring plane back button that doesn't actually exist in the real world. "Sir, please step back and do not touch the equipment. You can't stop me from boarding my flight." Now at this point, you'd think Mr. Ego would realize the gravity of his actions and calm down. But oh no, he doubled down on a crazy. he tried to force their way past the gate agent and onto the jet bridge. "I must insist you step back. You're causing a disturbance and I won't hesitate to call security." Well, that was a final straw. Security was called and they arrived in no time. But Mr. Ego was not one to back down without a final showdown.
"You can't do this. I know my rights."
Security tells him, "Sir, you need to cooperate and leave the gate area peacefully.
You'll all regret this. I'll sue the airline, the airport, and everyone involved."
As he continued to rant about their plans for world domination or whatever, security calmly guided Mr. Ego away from the gate. The rest of us looked on, grateful that this absurd show was finally coming to an end. In the end, he got a one-way ticket to a different kind of destination, Handcuffsville. As for me, I boarded my flight a little later than expected, but with a smile on my face, knowing that life is full of unexpected adventures, both on the ground and in the air. Bon voyage, my friends.
Oh man, that story had me rolling. Can you believe the audacity of Mr. Ego? I mean, seriously, who does he think he is? Captain Marvel or the CEO of the Airline Avengers? Well, let's be real, we've all encountered some entitled folks in our lives, right? This guy took tardiness to a whole new level. I couldn't help but admire the gate agent's composure through the whole crazy ordeal. Kudos to them. And did you catch that epic moment when he tried to hit the imaginary bring plane back button on the gate agent's computer? Classic move. If only things worked that way in real life, we'd never be late for anything. But hey, let's give credit to the other passengers too for not holding back with their hilarious comments.
"Get over yourself, buddy. We all have places to be," you tell him.
What's important is that in the end, Mr. Ego learned a valuable lesson about humility and landed himself in Handcuffsville, the destination we all hope to avoid. Guys, don't forget to hit that like button, leave your witty comments, and definitely subscribe for more crazy stories like this one. And now, let's dive into our next story from today's episode. First things first, let me introduce myself. I live in a quiet suburban neighborhood. I love my little slice of heaven, and I take great pride in keeping my lawn green and properly mowed. But as with any tale worth telling, there is always that one person who adds a little spice to your life. And in my case, it's my lovely neighbor, Karen. Karen is your quintessential Karen. A middle-aged woman with a penchant for unreasonable demands and a dog, Fluffy, who believes my front yard is his personal potty. Now, don't get me wrong, I love dogs as much as the next person. But this was getting out of hand. It wasn't just an occasional slip-up. It was a daily doggy-do drama. I tried talking to Karen about the issue multiple times, but it was like talking to a brick wall. She would always respond with a dismissive,
"Oh, Fluffy is just being a dog. Let him be."
Well, I had enough of stepping on unwanted landmines on my own lawn. One day, after another pointless conversation with Karen, I decided to take matters into my own hands. Literally. Armed with a shovel and a healthy dose of passive aggressiveness, I donned my poop-picking gloves and went on a covert operation to clean up Fluffy's mess. I scooped up the putrid presents that Fluffy had left behind on my property, then I deposited the bayload on Karen's doorstep, right across the street from my house. It was like a reverse ding-dong ditch. But instead of ringing the doorbell, I left a stinky surprise. I felt like I was taking my stand against canine injustice. The next morning, I woke up feeling interested in how Karen would react to her special delivery. I had installed a doorbell camera a while back because, well, you never know what kind of shenanigans may happen in a neighborhood like ours. That day, the camera was about to record something that would leave me in stitches for weeks. At precisely 10:37 a.m., the footage caught Karen marching towards her front door. And as she reached to open the door, she stepped on a very dog poop I had strategically placed there. She lost it. She tried aggressively getting it off as fast as she can, but right when you think it can't get any better than this, she loses her balance after performing the most awkward dance trying to get the poop off her shoe, and she falls off to the ground right on top of the dog poop. It was like watching a slow motion comedy sketch unfold right before my eyes. I'm pretty sure I heard that poink sound effect as her pivotal foot
flew out from under her. Down went Karen right into the steaming pile of doggy doo-doo. It was a sight so ridiculous that even the squirrels stopped their current gathering to have a good laugh. I couldn't help but burst into fits of laughter myself, almost choking on my coffee in the process. It then appears that Karen shot a crazy glare in the direction of my house, her face now smeared with dog poop, and her clothes looking like a Jackson Pollock painting. "You did this!" she screamed, pointing a finger at my house. So I step out of my house, sip on my coffee, and I tell her, "Oh Karen, you really need to watch your step. Maybe it's time for Fluffy to learn some bathroom manners." Karen's humiliation didn't stop there. She decided to call in her husband for backup. But when I showed him the video, we had an okay relationship, me and him. He couldn't help but laugh himself. He turned to Karen and said, "Honey, I think you should take this as a sign to clean up after Fluffy. You can't just let him do his business wherever he pleases." As much as I wanted to gloat and say, "I told you so," I decided to keep the peace. Besides, the sight of Karen covered in dog poop was enough vindication for me. In the days that followed, Karen was surprisingly cautious about where Fluffy did his business, and I finally had a poop-free yard. It seemed that my unconventional approach had actually worked. Of course, Karen didn't go down without a final show of entitlement. She threatened to sue me, claiming that I had intentionally set a trap for her, but fortunately, my doorbell camera footage proved otherwise. Her husband even told her that she had brought this upon herself with her stubbornness. In the end, nothing came of Karen's threats, and life in the neighborhood returned to its usual peaceful rhythm. And that is a story of how a neighborhood feud turned into a comedy of errors, all thanks to a dog, some poop, and an entitled Karen.
Oh man, that story was pure gold. I couldn't stop laughing while reading about Karen's crazy doggy doo drama. I mean, we all have those quirky neighbors, but Karen takes the cake with her entitled attitude and Fluffy's poop on demand routine. Can you imagine dealing with that daily? I'd be losing my mind too. But kudos to OP for taking matters into their own hands with a covert operation and strategic poop placement. It's like a revenge plot straight out of a sitcom. And then a doorbell camera caught it all. Karen's epic slip and slide right into her own dog's mess. It's like the universe decided to give her a taste of her own medicine. Karma at its finest. But hey, in the end, it seems like Karen finally learned her lesson and started cleaning up after Fluffy. Mission accomplished. And now let me walk you through our next story on the menu today. I have to tell you, I'm not a real big Reddit contributor, but I read a lot of those posts in this and several other subs. One thing for certain, I never expected to have a story to contribute to out of work here lady subreddit. Many of the posts seem fake to me, but I'll never take them for granted again. This story has a Karen, a Ken, and two very sweet millennial young ladies who I will call Barbie 1 and Barbie 2. I own a corporation in financial services and insurance that requires me to meet primarily with business owners on a regular basis. I'm providing products that they are required to have, and these are big dollar financial service and insurance products. About 90% of my business is in my office, but about 10% of my clients I will visit in their shops or homes, especially the really top-level clients. Last Wednesday, I stopped by one of my clients' place of business. We will call him Eddie. Eddie owns a fancy donut shop that is very popular and has a line around the building every single day. During COVID, his line was literally halfway around the block due to distancing. I came near the end of his rush and I set up some papers and my laptop to the right of his register while he finished the short line that was left. He checked people out on the other side and I was not near the donuts or the customers. And I thought nothing of it. This becomes important in the story, so I should tell you that I am a 450-pound guy. I'm big, really big, and I'm proud of it. The name calling and stares don't really bother me. As I waited and continued to pull up the information I'd need for my client, Eddie went in the back to grab some trays of donuts and told the next customers in line, Karen and Ken, that he'd be right back. Apparently, Ken and Karen didn't want to wait as I heard the ever so famous, ahem, a couple of times before finally looking up at them to see who wasn't responding to them. I didn't think they were trying to get my attention, but they were. I didn't even get a word out and Karen blurted out,
"How about you get up and help out? We just need half dozen glazed and the other guy disappeared."
I said, "Ma'am, I'm sorry, but he just went back to grab some new trays of donuts. He'll be back in just a few minutes. Since I don't work here, I wouldn't have the first clue on how to help you. I am sorry." Karen literally chuckles out loud, rolls her eyes, shakes her head, and looks at Ken in a "he's lying and just being lazy." Then Ken immediately turns his head to me and says,
"Look, buddy, we just need 6 donuts. It'll take you just 30 seconds and put them in a box and ring us up, and you can go back to lounging on your stool."
I responded in kind, "Well, buddy, I don't work here, and I have no idea how to work the register and help you. Plus, you know, I don't work here and all." Karen, now standing behind Ken on her tippy toes, like she wants him to go all MMA on me. She looks up and says,
"Who's your boss? Was that bad guy who went to get more donuts, or do you have another manager?"
Again, I tried. "Ma'am, I own my own company. I'm here on personal business with the owner, Eddie. He's the same gentleman that went in the back, yes, but he's not my boss. I really don't work here." Just then, Eddie comes back out, slides the new trays in, and asks Karen and Ken if he can help them. Karen, leaning hands and rest first on a counter, says to Eddie,
"Yeah, you can stop hiring lazy fat people who don't want to help your customers. What do you do? Pay him in crawlers?"
This made Eddie very confused, and I spoke up and said to him, "Well, this woman thinks I work here because I'm behind the counter. I tried to tell her that I didn't, but supposedly, I am too fat and lazy not to work here or something. Anyway, they want half dozen of something." Eddie turns to Karen and Ken and asks if they were being rude. They started to speak, but thankfully Barbie 1 and Barbie 2 came to my defense. They were in line behind Karen and Ken and had heard the whole ordeal. They started speaking up, explaining that these people were awful, rude, and just plain mean. After hearing that, Eddie simply kicked them out and told them not to come back. Ken wasn't quite done though. As he leaves, he turns and says,
"Thanks so much for your help, you fat jerk. I hope you have a heart attack before you turn 50.
I'm 53, by the way." Then they left without incident. Why don't they believe someone who says that they don't work there? It's so strange, and of course, now that it's over, all of the great comebacks are in my head that I missed. But I'll be ready next time if it happens again.
Can you believe that crazy encounter with Karen and Ken? I mean, seriously, who do they think they are? Demanding donuts from OB like they own the place. And that lazy fat people comment? Not cool, Karen and Ken. Not cool at all. But let's give a shout out to Barbie 1 and 2 for swooping in like superheroes to defend OP's honor. Go team! But you know what? I bet those entitled folks are still scratching their heads, wondering why they got the boot. Well, Karen and Ken, maybe next time you'll think twice before treating people with such disrespect. Now, my friends, let's keep the laughs rolling. On to the next one. I was flying to Vegas to have a series of meetings with clients at a convention that was going on at one of the casinos. As I arrive at the casino, I walk up and go through the velvet ropes to wait my turn at the check-in counter. As a person finished up, the check-in staff called me up to check-in. I take one step towards the front desk and the entitled person rushes in front of me, cutting me off to get to the desk before me. I roll my eyes, say something under my breath, and take a step back into the line. I hadn't hit my rude and entitled person limit yet, so I was just fine waiting. I have no idea what deal that person was trying to negotiate up there, but it was taking a while and involved a lot of hand gesturing. Eventually, that person was happy enough with whatever upgrade or deal they got, and the exacerbated chick and staff called me up. I'm the type that kills all help staff with kindness. They are here to help me and I let them know I appreciate it one way or another. My interaction with the staff was no different. I gave him pleasantries, niceties, and killed him with kindness while he helped me. Halfway through check-in, a manager comes out of the door behind the gentleman helping me
pulls him aside and has a conversation with him. Afterwards, the staff comes back to me. He says, "Well, I have good news."
"Oh yeah? What is it?"
"I'm thinking of a free voucher or breakfast type deal. We are going to go ahead and upgrade your room to a presidential suite at no charge."
Snickerdoodle. I didn't say that, obviously. I have no idea what I said.
What can you say when hit with something like that? I honestly don't remember any more of the conversation with the staff due to shock, other than thanking them about 100 times. The bellhop loads my luggage on a cart / trolley and says, "Please follow me, sir." He takes me to a special elevator, shows me how to use a key to get to the presidential level, takes me on a tour of the amenities on the floor, and then asks, "Would you like a tour of your room?" "Yes, I would love a tour of my room." And there was a tour of the room's foyer / entryway, meeting room, living room, bedroom, massive bathroom, sitting room, and a few other rooms. Now, that may not sound like a lot to tour, but these rooms were big and had a lot of amenities in them, including the various buttons to summon a personal attendant when I needed them. How big was the place? Well, one morning I was hanging out in the sitting room waiting for my first meeting. I came out after a while to realize that the cleaning staff was cleaning the room, and neither of us had any idea the other was there. I want to thank that entitled person for doing whatever they did to result in me getting upgraded to a presidential suite in Vegas. Oh, OP's Vegas adventure had it all. An entitled person trying to cut in line, a patient chicken staff dealing with wild negotiations, and finally, the ultimate surprise upgrade to a presidential suite, Snickerdoodle. That's crazy. I gotta say, OP's kindness paid off big time, and they scored the swankiest room in the casino. Can you imagine the shock and excitement that they felt when they heard those magic words? Presidential suite at no charge? I would have been dancing like crazy. And then the bellhop takes them on a tour fit for royalty. I mean, the size of that place was insane. Rooms upon rooms. Yeah, I bet that was sweet. Anyways, guys, if you want more jaw-dropping stories and unexpected adventures, don't forget to hit that first link in the description below to watch another amazing video. And of course, it would be appreciated if you show some love with likes, comments, and subscribing. We've got loads more fun in store for you. Thanks for tuning in, and I'll catch you in the next one.